Hi y'all, meteorologist Andy Hill here at the Weather Forecasting Desk. Let's talk weather. A big blast, or two, or three, of that springtime air is coming this week through April Fool's Day for many of us in the US and even into southeastern Canada. Later this week, some of y'all are going to experience some real flower-budding, tree-leafing warmth, as you can see here. Shortly after you feel those temps, some of y'all are going to experience the consequences of this wave rolling through in the form of severe weather, and some of y'all are locked into a stagnant, dreary winter 2.0. I mean, basically the entire western half of the US is looking at these below average temperatures at some point coming up, with many areas just staying way too cold for comfort for way too long. This is all happening now because spring is a transitional season. That means a lot of us in these latitudes will literally transition between warm and cold quite often because the atmosphere is constantly trying to balance itself while we get more sunlight into summer. As a result of the traditional season, it's a little more difficult to tell further out, but I'm gonna do my best to give y'all an extended outlook starting today. From my last video 5 days ago, I explained that there was a high likelihood of this low-pressure system migrating southward from the Gulf of Alaska to the California coast. Well, it's come here this morning now. Here it is on the Bay of San Francisco Tuesday morning, with heavy rain from Santa Rosa all the way down to San Diego along the coast, and also heavy snow in the Sierra Nevadas and the coastal ranges, and even some heavy rain showing up in the interior valleys. Possibly even up to 4 to 6 inches of rain where we have upslope flow to the mountains in the foothills here in Southern California. Those amounts warrant a moderate risk for our day one excessive rainfall from the Weather Prediction Center. So be prepared for flash flood warnings to show up later today on your phones in this area. And since this storm is originating from the Gulf of Alaska, it's gonna be a cold one. Some of the coastal range down here could see a up to 2 feet of snow, and areas of 3 to 4 feet are likely in parts of the southern Sierras. I would not be surprised if the strong forcing in place managed to tilt and spin up some updrafts, therefore creating water spouts in the areas off the coasts of maybe Los Angeles and San Diego. So after today, the first storm that'll come through the east of the Rockies is a shortwave. So over the next few days, that shortwave, along with the main storm system, is going to cause plenty of snow in the Intermountain West before it finally finds its way to the Plains. This little shortwave will bring unsettled weather into the northern plains, Midwest, the northeast US, as well as all of Ontario. Most of this will be rain, except where that cold air stays in place on the northwest of the rain snow line here, roughly along this line. Snow totals from the first round will be around 2 to 4 inches for much of South Dakota, North Dakota, and northern Minnesota into northwest Ontario. By Friday, this looks to be a real dumper for the area around the St. Lawrence River mouth here in the Gulf of St. Lawrence. On Wednesday afternoon, much of the plains here is going to see temperatures in the 70s Fahrenheit, including the deep south as well. That's replacing a lot of our freezing temperatures in the morning down here. And look at this, even Oklahoma and Texas could reach 85 Fahrenheit in places here near Wichita Falls and Abilene, Texas. The entire Ohio Valley River area into the mid-Atlantic, even as far north as possibly New York City, could reach 70 degrees Fahrenheit on Friday afternoon. A cold front will push these temperatures just a little bit south here, but the front will stall out right in this area. The main storm bringing severe weather and warm air further north then comes through the plains beginning Thursday and rolls northeast with time through early Sunday the 26th of March. So this system is going to produce severe weather here in Texas and also southern Oklahoma on Thursday the 24th, going up to a slight risk or a 2 out of 5. And then that risk is going to move to the east here on Friday and encompass much of this area, including southwestern Louisiana, Jackson, Mississippi, all the way up to possibly Memphis, Tennessee, and areas of southwestern Tennessee. With significant rising motion out ahead of this thing, I expect this storm system to bear a classic squall line as it moves through Texas and Oklahoma, and that squall line should carry a threat for damaging winds as well as isolated hail and possibly tornadoes if there are any discrete supercells in the mix. You can see these gaps in between the expected risk areas on Thursday here into Friday. This gap is where storms are expected to be overnight Thursday into Friday morning, where they lack the daytime heating needed to fuel them. Once we're in the daytime on Friday, solar energy will once again fuel the storms in this area to the east, meaning that there will be once again a damaging wind threat and possibly supercells evolving in front of the cold front, which would pose a threat for all hazards. In addition, this area right here may be raining the entire day of Friday, as y'all are right on that stalled front from the previous storm. The front will continue to serve as a local storm maker in this area until it's pushed out of the way by the main show, as you can see there. Rain totals for these areas could be as high as 4 to 5 inches in the red there, where it's pouring most of the day on Friday. There's good agreement that frozen precipitation will be in attendance with this storm as well. I think anyone in this circle has a great chance at seeing some frozen precipitation on Saturday into Saturday afternoon, and perhaps north of this line roughly on Saturday evening into Sunday we'll see some snow as well. You'll want to be a little further north or higher up in elevation to see that snow accumulate. That third punch is possible into next Tuesday. It seems that around then, more unhappy, unsettled weather is possible for both sides of the country. For the east next Monday into Tuesday, check out this disagreement. The European model kicks this storm out to sea, bringing some snow into New England and some remaining moisture and precipitation in the southeastern states. While the global forecast system, or the GFS model, tries to intensify the system once it gets off the coast into quite the nor'easter here. It's a little too far out for us to nail down what's going to happen, but what I can tell you is that there's going to be unsettled weather in this region. Even if this third storm doesn't pan out in a significant way, check out the Climate Prediction Center's outlook for the end of March to April Fool's Day. Anywhere in the purple is looking at some possible heavy snow. Anywhere in the green is looking at a slight risk for some heavy precipitation, so some heavy rainfall in particular rather than snow. And areas in the brown are also going to see a chance for some gusty winds in this region through April 1st. These areas on the West Coast are also the precursor to what would happen over here on the East as we go into the beginning of April. So we have a chance for heavy snow into late March, heavy rainfall once again, and also high winds along the Pacific Northwest coast. Let me show you the reasons why my fellow meteorologists at the Climate Prediction Center are forecasting these giant risk areas this far out. Here's another big blue blob that's originating from the Gulf of Alaska. It's going to slide down the Pacific coast here in some fashion unknown to us yet, and then eventually be driven inland. As it travels down the coast, it'll likely bring plenty of rain snow to the Pacific Northwest regardless of intensity, but where it ends up and who gets the worst of it in California remains to be seen. Is there an end for California anytime soon? The Climate Prediction Center says we might be on the downswing for April after these ridiculous winter storms that have come one after the other for the Southwest US. While I really want to include as much of the longer term weather outlooks in these videos as I possibly can, don't fret. I still care about the short term and the now casting elements there is to winter weather, severe weather, and even tropical weather later this year. I will absolutely cover severe weather live on YouTube in depth here on this channel. They're possible for significant severe weather days coming up, so make sure you turn on notifications on this channel for those. Of course, I'll still be working closely with Ryan as I have been for the last year. If any particular risk turns out to be intense and require all hands on deck, I will prioritize assisting the team as I have been on Ryan's channel for the past year. So keep an eye out for me over there too. I'll always be the Nader Investigator.